There is a book called Kol Mevaser, Responsa Kol Mevaser. It's written by Rav Meshulam Rat, who's the direct grandfather of my wife. Rav Meshulam Rate, in his ingenious writings, wrote a full explanation of our sugya, which is Daf Pei, page 80, in Tractate Psachim, and he elaborate in that responsa. So basically, the study today will be based on the Rav Meshulam Rate Kol Mevaser explanation of this sugya. Just a side note, Rav Herzog, the father of the late Israeli president, when he was the chief rabbi of Israel, once they have the chief rabbinate meeting, and member of the headquarters chief rabbinate was Rav Meshulam Rate. So I heard it from several sources that at the end of the meeting, Rav Herzog went and put the big rabbi's long coat and put it from the closet and help Rav Meshulam Rat and put it on him at the end of that meeting. So a few people said, you know, you are the Rav Rashi, you are the chief rabbi, you know, why are you doing that? It's inappropriate. And he answered and he said, I'm covering the Sefer Torah, living, walking Sefer Torah. So just to go to show you that even the Chabina Rav said about him was a great scholar. So anyway, based on Kol Mevaser, we are page 80, 11 lines from the top of the page. Itmar, היו ישראל מחצת תאורים ומחצת מאים, המרב מתמאים אחד מהן בשרץ. We have in our discussion the issue of total half and a half. Half of the people were ritually pure, half of the people were not pure. Now the question is, when they attached to a creeping animal, if the majority of the people will then be ritually impure and they will sacrifice the Paschal lamb in a state of ritual impurity. So they said yes, because they bring it as a tzibur, as a public, so we can do it. Rav hold that anyone who's become ritually impure at the eve of Passover, for example, if he touch a creeping animal, so he cannot bring the Paschal lamb. Even it's enough time to do the ritual purity. So the Gemara said, Ve'amai, they ask why. Ne'avdu hane lechudayu, ve'hane lechudayu. We can have some perform the ritual of the Paschal lamb on their own in a state of purity, and the other will do it in a state of impurity, as we explained yesterday. Ve'ha amar Rav, we just mentioned Rav earlier, halalu osim le'atzman. One group does that in a state of purity, ve'halalu osim le'atzman, and the other group does that in a state of impurity. Amrei acha b'may askinan, kegon shehayu tme'in odfin al ha'teorim echad. People who are ritually impure were more even with one single person. So, in that sense, the pure is the minority. So they cannot perform the Paschal lamb while they are in a state of purity. If that's the case, so the tzibur, the majority, or it's already ritually impure, so we can make this offering together in a state of ritually impurity. So why we need to have another person make him impure? Savala ki Rabbi Elazar ben Matya, d'amar ena yachid machre et hatzibur letumah, that he said that one individual that is ritually impure cannot force the whole community to be ritually impure. So the Gemara asks, yachay adar kushen leduchte. So we go back to our question, because according to Rabbi Elazar ben Matya, It's exactly the case of half and a half. Niavdu ane lechudayu, v'ane lechudayush. That each group should make it separate, one group pure and one group the other, not pure. Ela hachi ke'amar. That's the way Rav meant. I katana de savarla ketana kama. If there is one that holds the same as Tanakama, the Amar Palga Ufalga lo avli kulu betuma, that he said half and a half, it's half in the community pure and half is impure. They do not perform the ritual of Paschal Lamb in a state of impurity. Vesavala ki Rabbi Yuda, and he holds according to the opinion of Rabbi Yuda, the Amar who said en korban tzibur chaluk, the communal offering is not divided, because otherwise you can't have the tzibur divided to separate groups, since some of the people make it in the sense of being a ritual impurity. So it's look very unbecoming to have some or pure, some not pure. Basically the idea is that according to Rav, half of the tzibur is considering the majority, and since most of the people tzibur, they cannot do Pesach Sheni, so that's the Rav opinion. Rav Yehuda said that they can do Pesach Sheni. So if is someone who agreed to these two opinions, and he holds that people who are ritually pure can join with people who are ritually impure, as long as it's not the majority of ritually impure. But anyway, we not allow the people of pure to make a separate entity, a separate group, and make the person while they are pure. Why? He said, "Metamim echad mehen besheretz." You know what you do? We render impure one of those who are pure with the creeping animal. So then the majority will be ritually impure, and therefore even the people of pure can join the offering while they're in state of ritual impurity. You sent away to long distance one of them. So the people who left were ritually impure, and he can do the Paschal Lamb while they are ritually impure. So there is a big discussion, Tosfot have a discussion, another, the Tzlach, the Rashash, why you take someone who's ritually pure should take someone who's ritually impure. Anyway, so the Gemara asks, "V'tam'enu besheret." So how about if let them render him impure with creeping animal, which is the easier to implement, and then it postponed to the second Pesach, "Kasavar shochtin v'zorkin al t'me sheret," because he said that the Paschal Lamb and sprinkle the blood even for someone who is ritually impure with creeping animal, because then he can eat the Paschal Lamb in the evening. So the Gemara asked, "V'tam'enu bemet?" Should be rendered impure by touching the corpse. So why need to send him to a long distance? So they said, "Madcheu atam mechagigato," because you will defer him from his festival peace offering. Because if you make contact on the 13th of Nisan, so he cannot bring Korban Chagiga on the 15th of Nisan, because he's still impure. But someone who's attached a dead person, so he cannot bring it to Chagiga offering. Because someone who sent away can return to Yerushalayim and bring it. So they said, "Hashtanami matcheu atami lasot pischo." So here too, by sending one person to a distant place, you're disqualifying him from sacrificing his Paschal Lamb. So they said, "Efshar de'avid b'sheni." Maybe he can make the korban in the second Pesach. So they said, "Bemet name efshar de'avid b'shvi, de'aval shmini shelo." So he said, in the corpse, you can change to the 7th day of Passover. That is basically the 8th day of his ritually impure. Kasavar Ula, kulu tashlumim derishonim. Ula holds that all the days of the festival on which one may sacrifice festival peace offering are rendered from what one is obligated but unable to bring the first day. So he said, "Chazeh barishon bekulo, chazeh bekulo." Kol echad lo chazeh barishon lo chazeh bekulo. One is fit bringing the offering the first day is fit for all of them. But whenever one is not fit for the first day, is not for all of them. So what we understand that if a person contacted dead corpse, the 14th day of month of Nisan, we are basically delayed years bringing the Chagigah offering for the festival, and the resolution only is to send him to a far away. So, otherwise we can come close to Yerushalayim during the day. Amar lo Rav Nachman, zilu ve'amu lei le'ula man tzayet de'akar sikeh u'mashkeneh ve'rahit. So show me who is the person who is willing to uproot his pegs and tent and run to a distant place. Show me that person. So that's the way Rashi understands. Tosfot said that since they slaughter and sprinkle for someone who would attach to a creeping animal, so you cannot do it the way that Rav said. So, anyway, there is a discussion among the Meforshim what exactly involved you, how you sent him away. Itmar. Now, the Gemara dealing here with other situation with the public ritual impurity. Hayuhu ban zavim. Most of the people have issue or with discharge. Umiutan tmeim eitim. Some touching to a corpse. Amarav utam tmeim eitim enanusim lo pesach rishon lo pesach sheni. Those who touch the corpse cannot touch neither the first nor the second Pesach. Rishon lo avde davi miuta. The first one is the minority. Miuta lo avde berishon. So they don't do it during the first Pesach. Sheni nami lo avde de kol echad avde tzibur berishon avid yachid basheni. Anytime that the people, there's the rishon, individual can do it, that it was ritually impure, can do it the second time. Kol echad lo avde tzibur berishon lo avid yachid basheni. When the tzibur did not do it the first day, so individual cannot do it to the second chance. So Zavim, the Meir, he said, not doing neither first nor the second. First, because it's not postponed, it's not Yidche. The Sheni, because public is not postponed to the second Pesach. So they said, Amar lo Shmuel Zilu, Amru le Abba, go and say to Father Rav the sentence in the Bamidbar chapter 9, Ve'yasu bnei Yisrael le Pesach b'moado. Maya vadet le. So how do you explain this line that they should have to do the Pesach on time? So he said, Amar lehu, Zilu emru le ki'avu kulu zavin. Maya Valtley, if they are all Zavim, what do you do? How do you say that nobody can do the Paschalem? Only if the majority of the people are ritually impure. So, Amar Lehu, Zelu Amar Ulei, go and say to Shmuel, Ki Avu Kulu Zavim Maya Valtley, Ela Mekivan De Lo Efshar, Chanam Lo Efshar. So you cannot do it, you cannot do it. If the majority of the public were ritually impure from impurity intended by a corpse on the first Pesach, so miutam zavim, and some of them they cannot do the first Pesach because they have those discharge. Ravun amar en tashmin le Pesach abba betuma. You can't go to the second Pesach if it was ritually impure the first one. Because they said that the chance for those ritually impure to do a second time only if majority of the people, the Rov HaTzibur, did it the first time. So, Ravada Barava Amar Yesh Tashlumin LePesach Haba Betumah. He says, yes, you can do it a second time. Neimar Ba'akam Yifligei. The Mar Savar, Ein Tashlumin LePesach Haba Betumah Kesavar, Tumat Chiyuah Betzibur. Uman Amar Yesh Tashlumin LePesach Haba Betumah Kesavar, Tumah Utra Betzibur. So, Tumah Utra Betzibur, Rashi said that the Torah allowed the people all this ritual impurity, the prohibition, they allow that. So when the most of the people are ritually impure, so considering pure, and they can postpone all these people who have a discharge to the second Pesach. That's called Tumah Utra Betzibur. So he said, Amrei, Lo, Ela Dekule Alma Tumah Tchuya Betzibur. Which means that Torah allowed the prohibition of Tumah only for the sake of public. Ubeapligei, the machloket is Mar Savar, it's a disputation. Mar, which is Ravuna, who said that is no rendered hold. Pei Amud Bet, ATB, Tahara, Medachya, Tumah lo Medachya. So if the people take a paschal lamb and in a state of purity, so they defer those who are unable to bring the offering for the second Pesach. But a paschal lamb brought in a state of impurity does not defer those who are unable to bring the offering to the second Pesach. Umar Saval, afilu tum'an ame midachya. And Rav Ala Bar Ava, who said that he's a he holds that even a paschal lamb offered in a state of ritual impurity defer those who are unable to bring the offering in the second Pesach. So even that is a tumah, it's a dechuya betzibur. So the power of this tzibur is to postpone it to the second Pesach for those who cannot join them. Again, in the Kol Mevaser, you see here the notes, is a lot of elaboration on that. Itma, Ayush Lishitan Zavin. By the way, those who want to get the book, is Shelot V'Tshuvot Kol Mevaser, Otzat Mosad Rav Kook, Yerushalayim. It's an excellent responsive book dealing with a lot of practical halachot. He was a Rav in Chernovitz, and he was in the Moetzet Rabbanut HaRashit, in one of the leading scholars at the beginning of State of Israel, and very close friend to my late grandfather, Rabbi Yaakov Yitzchak Weissblum. So, anyway, Itmar, Ayush Lishitan Zavin. One third of the public have an issue of discharge, semen discharge. Ushlishatam Teorim, Shlishatam Tmei Metin. One third pure, one third have ritual impurity by touching a corpse. Omar Rab Mani Bar Patish, Otam Tmei Metin, and Anusin Lo Et HaRishon Lo Et HaSheni. Those who touch to a corpse cannot do neither one, the first Pesach, nor the second Pesach. But those who pure can do it Bar Rishon, as the Meiri said. Bar Rishon Lo Avdei, Igdilu Zavin Latorin. The first one they don't do because the people who have an issue of discharge, there are more. The law of the betumah that you cannot bring the paschal lamb while you are in a state of ritual impurity. So if you tell me that paschal lamb can do in the ritual impurity, so those who have discharge cannot participate in that. So therefore, you cannot register, cannot count those who have discharge in order to have the majority of impure. Havelet me metim miuta. Those who contact to a corpse, the minority, umiuta lo avde barishon, and the minority cannot do it the first day. Besheni lo avde is zavin itmei metim, the lo avde barishon, havu lo ruba veruba lo matcho lepesach sheni. So he said that the zavim are joined with those who are ritually impure with impurity imparted by a call, who did not perform the ritual of the paschal lamb on the first Pesach. So consequently, they are the majority. And the offering of the majority is not deferred to the second Pesach. So that's the way Rashi understands it. But Rabbi Akiva Iger and Minchat Chinuch in Shin Pei go and say that those who touch to a corpse cannot go even for the second Pesach, because number one, only the minority did the Pesach in the first place, and since it does, and also because the people who touch in a corpse cannot go for the second time. So, but anyway, there is a lot of discussion here on the Chazon Ish. There's a Rambam, Hilchot Korban Pesach, chapter 7, and more. Let's go to the Mishnah. What happened with one individual that bring the offering while he is the Paschal Lamb, while he is ritually impure? HaPesach sheNizrak Damo, v'achar kach noda shehu tameh. So they sprinkle the blood of the Paschal Lamb, and suddenly they realize that he is ritually impure. Hatitz meratze alav. So Tosfot said he cannot eat the meat, but the tzitz, the top of the head of the Kohen, it's appeased. He doesn't want to go to a Pesach Sheni. However, if after the fact he realized, the Meiri said, Nitma haguf, that the owner of this offering attached to a corpse, and a tzitz meratze, so the tzitz not appeased, and he needs to go to do the second Pesach. Mipnei shamru, because the sages said in regards to a Nazirite, Hanazir ve'ose Pesach hatzitz meratze al tumat adam ve'neratzitz meratze al tumat aguf. They said that both Nazirite and the someone who brings the Paschal Lamb, the tzitz, the front plate, appease God for both impurity in the blood, but the front plate does not appease God for impurity of the body of the individual bringing the offering. So basically, when the Nazirite complete his days of being a Nazir, and then it turns that the blood or the time of sprinkling was not pure, so the front plate appease for that offering. So they said, Nitma tumat hatehom. But if he become impure to the ritual impurity of the deep, which is, if he was informed that there was a concealed grave under the place he had set in the house where he had previously stayed. So it means that this is a tumah that he never recognized, he never knew about it. So he said, Atzitz meratze. So the front plate is appeased God and the offering is valid. So the Vilna Gaon have a lot of explanation what exactly happened in the Tumat HaTehom. Because basically the tzitz is not machshir korban tameh, it's not making the impure offering ready, but it's just alachal Moshe Sinai, that we receive a tradition from Moses to Sinai that this type of ritual impurity of the deep, we understand that it's not the opposite of this act of Nezirut, and it's not require a person to go to the Pesach Sheni. Tama, the Gemara said, the reason that the front plate appears, because then Nizrak v'achagach nodal. Remember, first he sprinkled, and then he realized that this offering is impure. Aval nodal v'achagach Nizrak. But if it's be opposite, if it's he realized, become known, ritually impure, and the blood was subsequently sprinkled, the front plate, lo meratze, not appease God, and the offering is disqualified. Veraminu, now we ask the other brayta, says, al matzitz meratze, what exactly the front plate appease God? So they said, al adam, v'al habasar, v'al hachelev shenitma. It's applied to the blood, the meat and the fat that became impure. Bein b'shogeg, regardless if it's unintentionally, ben b'mezid, even that is in a circumstance that is intentional, ben b'ones, which means beyond a person's control, ben beratzon, willfully, ben beyachid, ben beziboy, regardless if it's individual or in public. All these cases, the frontal that pleased God, even when the blood was sprinkled, despite the fact that it was already known that the meat or blood was ritually impure. So Rashi explained that the language, regardless is shogeg or mezid, meaning he did this type of work, either shogeg or intentional or unintentional. So Ravina responds, Amar Ravina tumato ben beshoya ben mezid utza zrikato. If you talk about ritual impurity, so it's no different. It's appeased. But sprinkle the blood of the offering, if it's beshogeg utza, if it's unintentional, it's appeasing. But if bemezid lo utza, that's the way the Mishnah said. Rabbi Shela disagreed. Rabbi Shela said, zrikato ben beshogeg ben mezid utza. If they sprinkle the blood of the impure offering, whether it was done unwittingly or intentionally, it is accepted. Said beshogeg tumato beshogeg utza mezid lo utza. Which your ritual impurity become impure unwittingly, the offering is accepted. It become impure intentionally, it's not accepted. So, if you follow the Torah, it's no difference if it's a shogeg or mezid. Tosfot said that only the rabbis put a fine on him when it was a mezid, but not in additional of offering. But the reason that we use that it's regardless if it was intentional or not intentional. If it was unintentionally, it becomes ritually impure. But it says uzrako, when he sprinkled the blood, ben beshogeg ben mezid utza, regardless if it's intentional or not intentional, is accepted. But we are told that the blood was sprinkled and subsequently became known that the offering is impure. One should not infer that the reason for the front part of the peace God is specifically that the blood was sprinkled. But it's also if he became known and the blood was subsequently sprinkled. והיידי קטן נזרק ואחר כך נודע משום דבר למתנה סייפה נתמר גוף ונציץ מרצה ואפילו נזרק ואחר נודע לו קטן הרי שנה מנזרק ואחר כך נודע. So basically it depends when he is aware of that, if it's before or after. So that's the issue when they if it's totally unintentional, the tzitz appease, the front blade appease, otherwise not. By Rami Bar Chama, learn in the Mishnah that if the person who bring the korban, he is nitma tumata tehom, he's involved with a very deep sitting there, so the tzitz, the front blade appease. So by Rami Bachama, Rabbi Bachama asked, Kohen amerotze bekorbenotav, the Kohen that bring their offering with the Passover and the Nazirite, hutralo tumata tehom or lo? Which means that if you say that after his avoda, his work, if his body is a suffix tumah, it's not clear that he's a tumah or not. So if you tell me that the korban, the offering is valid, or you said no. So that's the difference. Mi amrinan, ki gmire tumat atomom bealim. Bechoin lo gmire. The halachon ha-mishim is Sinai apply, only if it's the owner, but if it's Kohen that does that, you don't say halachon ha-mishim is Sinai. Dilma bezivcha gmire, lo shna bekohen, lo shna bebealim. So halachon ha-mishim is Sinai apply to be lenient in tumat atomom. But it's no different between Kohen and Bealim. Amar Rav Tashma, Tanya Rav Chiya. Lo amru betumat ha-tehom, ela lemet milvad. They said it only in regards to a korb. Met lemahut emai. The korb to exclude the ritual impurity to what? Lav lemahut tumat ha-tehom, the sheretz. Pull his hand inside the dust. And he didn't realize that it's a creeping animal there. So we go and we say that we're lenient in the tumat tehom or not. Ubemaya skinan, inein bebealim. If you talk about the owner of this korban, uvemai, what type of korban? We told that you have to say that it is a nazirite or the paschal lamb. Benazir mimehanebei. told the Nazirites that the creeping animal that's avoiding him from bringing the offering. So he said, Ki amut bet alav bet apitom. The Torah said clearly in regard to the Nazir, Amar Rachmana, that that the first days it apply only to touching a corpse, but not the creeping animal. Ela be shoseda pesach, which means that you bring the paschal lamb, and then by touching creeping animal, that make it disqualified for that offering. Then you can ask, anicha lemad amaren shochatin v'zorkim al timei sheretz. You can go by one who said that you don't slaughter the paschal lamb and sprinkle for someone who is involved in the creeping animal. But אלא למען דאמר שוחטין וזורקים על תמי שרץ האשתה תומה ידועה ותרה לו תומה לתום לו כל שכן. So if you tell me that you talk about the שרץ, so since you allow a regular תומה ritual permit to him, so impurity of the deep is not is so much more true that is permitted to offer a paschal lamb. אלא לאו בכהן, you have to say, אבחיה is not referring to a כהן who has become ritually impure, הוא שמע מנה, הותרה לו דומה לתאום, for me the impurity in the deep is permitted for a כהן. אומר רב יוסף, לא, רב יוסף said, no, this cannot be proven by אבחיה's statement, לעולם מבעלים, you have to speak about the case that the owner become ritually impure and the impurity of the deep, ולמעותם בתאומת תאום דה זיבה, that intended to paschal lamb, and that's excluding impurity of the deep imparted by the discharge of the zabah. So the tzitz, the front plate, does not appease God with regard to ritual impurity from impure discharges that are known. So the Gemara asks, v'tumat tehom de ziva lo meratza, that the front plate did not appease God with regard to ritual impurity of the deep imparted by the discharge of the zabah. והתניה, רבי יוסי אומר שומרת יום כנגד יום, which means that a woman who keep watch day by day, a woman have a discharge of blood for one or two days at a time, and she does not accept that time of menstrual period. So when she experienced discharge for one day, ששחטו וזרקו עליה, when they slaughter the paschal lamb and sprinkle the blood, 81a, בשני שלה ואחר כך ראתה אינה אוכלת ופתורה מלעשות פסח שני. If it's the second day, so after she immersed in the ritual bath, so after that she saw the blood, so she may not eat the paschal lamb, but she exempt from performing the ritual of the second Pesach. מה הייתה מה? לאו משום דמרצה ציץ, not because they're from Pelapis God, he said, לא, אמרי לא, משום דקסבר רבי יוסי, מכאן לא לאבא ומתאמה. רבי יוסי hold that render object impure from now and onward. When a woman who keeps watch a day for a day, experience another discharge on the second day after she immerses a ritual bed, she is not retroactively considered to have been impure the entire time. Rather, she begins the new period of impurity from the time of her second discharge. So therefore, when a paschal lamb was slaughtered on her behalf, she was ritually impure. So we'll stop here and we'll go to practical halachot. Rambam, Sefer Korbanot, Hilchot Korban Pesach, chapter 4. Nitma haguf. If the body of individual who brought the paschal lamb had become ritually impure, if the owner of paschal lamb become ritually impure after it was slaughtered, the blood should not be sprinkled on the altar, even if the blood is sprinkled, the offering is not valid, and the owner are obligated to bring another offering during the second Pesach. Another halacha is in regard to tumata tom bekohen. If a kohen become ritually impure with impurity of the deep, even if he discovers this before sprinkling the blood on the altar and sprinkle it anyway, the offering is accepted. However, with regard to paschal lamb, he may sprinkle the blood even lechatchila. That's the case of Mishneh, as indicated by the continuation of the Gemara. That's Rambam. Now, the Rambam, Hilchot Beit HaMikdash, chapter 4. Tumat HaTehom, the leniency of impurity of a deep applies to ritual impurity imparted by a corpse that has not been discovered. According to the Ravid, this leniency does not apply to impurity from bodily discharges. Apparently, the Rambam maintains, based on the Gemara and Tractate Nazir, that was the Lecha Mishnah said, that the leniency of impurity of the deep applies even to bodily discharges, and that's Rambam, Hilchot Nezirut, chapter 6. Last halacha of today. So he said that in the case of dealing with the Zavon or Zava, who experienced discharge on the 7th of he or her clean days, so they need to immerse, and it's considered ritually impure retroactively. And you can see more in the Rambam Sefer Tahara, Ilchot, Metamei, Mishkav, Moshav, chapter 5.